screencast is split into two parts. In this first part, we'll look a bit into the math associated with confidence intervals. And in the second part, I'll demonstrate what confidence intervals actually mean using a series of graphical demonstrations. So in this screencast, I want to talk about the meaning of a confidence interval. By now, you're familiar with the mechanics and mathematics behind how you calculate one, but it's a little bit tough to interpret what it actually means, what you're actually doing. So for example, here we have an engineer that measures and records the temperature of boiling water, and he or she collects 5 different temperature measurements. And these 5 measurements constitute one sample. Don't confuse the number of measurements with the number of samples collected. So we collect those data, and you had 5 of them. The engineer reports, well, the 95% confidence interval for the mean water temperature is 97 plus or minus 6 degrees C. What does this plus or minus 6 degrees C mean? We might see it in a different form. Could be reported, the 95% confidence interval for the mean water temperature ranges from 91 to 103 degrees C. Or you might see it, the 95% UCL, it stands for the upper confidence limit for the water temperature is 103, or the 95% LCL is 91 degrees C. What we really want to get at is the true average, the true mean water temperature. We use the Greek letter mu to symbolize that. And if we knew that, we wouldn't need to do any of this confidence interval because we already know the true mean water temperature. But unfortunately, we never get to know that value. One reason we don't know it exactly is because all measurement devices have some degree of uncertainty. In this case, it could be that the thermocouple, if you put it in cold water, and then put it in hot water, and then put it back in cold water, it might be that if it was a lousy thermocouple, it could be off by a few degrees. And that difference between measurements prohibits us from making a distinct or an exact measurement of the population mean. Another reason could be if we looked at the tank of water, let's say that water was heated from below, we might expect a warm region of water at the bottom, and then everything above that is a little bit cooler. So it's important when you're taking temperature measurements of this vessel that you take your thermometer and measure temperatures over here, measure one up in here, another one at the bottom, kind of randomly over the place. So if you took 5 different measurements, you're going to be trying to take measurements at 5 random locations. And the true population mean for the water temperature is an average of an infinite number of measurements scattered randomly throughout the vessel. Obviously, we can't collect an infinite number of measurements. And it would also assume that our thermometer is perfect, that there's no variation whatsoever in the precision of our instrument. Neither of these things will be true. We can only capture, let's say you only had time to make 5 measurements, and you don't have a very expensive thermocouple, and that thermocouple has inherent uncertainty in its measurements. So these are all the reasons why you see these plus or minus values on different measurements, or if you see a range of measurements for the 95% confidence interval. But what does it mean? I mean, 95% of what? What is the significance of 95 even? And I'll tell you what it doesn't mean. It's a common misconception that it means that 95% of the measurements will fall between the range 91 degrees C to 103 degrees C, and that's not true at all. The best way I can come up with how to describe it is through a number of different simulations. But before we do that, for the technique that I'm using, and the technique that you probably started using, assumes that the population of all the measurements are normally distributed. So we'll be making that assumption throughout this screencast. And a normal distribution is this bell-shaped curve, which you're familiar with. And if we're taking water temperature measurements, this side could be relatively hot, this side could be relatively cold. If we were doing something else, like measuring the strength of an object, we pull on it until it breaks, and this object over here might be strong, and on the left side, these are weaker objects. And if they're normally distributed, the population mean would fall right here. But we don't ever get to know the population mean. All we get to know is if, in this case, we were breaking things, we might break something that's weak, something that's strong, we might grab. Ideally, if it's normally distributed, we'll capture some more measurements over here. There's a possibility there might be one that was particularly strong off to the right. So here I've made a sample size of n equals 6. if you took these six measurements and averaged them, we would come up with the sample mean, and typically it's x over bar represents the sample mean. Note that the sample mean does not match the population mean. Ultimately, this is what we want. We can't ever get at it, but we can get close and make some estimates as to how close we are to the true population mean. The simulation I'll show will present a graph. There'll be a bell-shaped curve, and we'll find a number of different data points that were gathered randomly across this normal distribution. So the computer will choose numbers that are more concentrated towards the center, and we might see a few of them at the outlier. So in this case, I've got a sample size of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and n is equal to 6. And if we wanted to, we could collect a few more samples, and presumably we'd have a higher sample density out here. And in this case, n is equal to 11. But note that I collected a sample of 11 measurements. I did not take 11 samples. What my simulation will also show is a horizontal line that represents the true population mean. And remember, in reality, we don't get to know the population mean, we don't get to know the distribution. All we're left with when you do an experiment are these values, these 11 values, and from these we have to figure out what the true population mean might be. Here's the results of one run of my simulation, and what I've got in the horizontal line is the population mean mu, which we're after. I'm showing the bell-shaped curve, which in reality you don't get to know, and in my simulation it picks random numbers that are more heavily concentrated towards the center of this curve. It can well pick points towards the top of it or at the bottom of it, but they're highly unlikely the further you move away from the population mean. And then what I've done is calculated the sample mean, x bar, and that's just the average of these three measurements. I've also plotted the 95% upper confidence limit and the 95% lower confidence limit. And this whole range from top to bottom is known as the 95% confidence interval. And the reason these are all 95% instead of, say, 90% or 99% is because I chose a value of alpha of 0.05. And I've also opted to collect three measurements for each sample. So if I rerun this, I would collect three more samples, but they wouldn't be in the same location. They'll be randomly distributed over this normal distribution. So things are going to look different every time I run the simulation. And what I want you to pay attention to is the number of times that the confidence interval does not contain the population mean. What this means is when I run the simulation over and over again, 95% of the time the population mean will be within these error bars. One example might be, let's say we had a class of 100 students, and each student took three measurements, one sample of materials that would pull apart, and you measure the force needed to pull the material apart. So strong material requires a large force, a weak material doesn't require much force at all. And in a pile of parts, if we were able to measure them, let's say we had 100,000 parts, and let's say we spent weeks measuring the breaking strength of all 100,000 parts, then we'd know the population mean. But unfortunately, it took us weeks to do that, and now we no longer have any parts to use because we broke all of them. But let's stick with this simulation. We can't break all the parts, we can't measure them all anyway. So we've got, it's a classroom environment, and each student collects a sample of three measurements. The 95% confidence interval is calculated by each student. So you go through the math you learned in class, calculate the 95% confidence interval. What this means is that, on average, 5 students out of 100 will calculate a confidence interval that does not contain the true population mean. However, we'll never know who those students are. We'll never know who truly encompassed the population mean or not, because nobody knows the true population mean. This is the end of part 1. See part 2 for a graphical demonstration of what confidence intervals actually mean.